Call to order the regular meeting of the North Reading School Committee, 6:33.
Actually, Mr. Chair, if I could just mention something to the superintendent. It's not an issue, but there's some sort of alarm going off in one of those chemical
in the prep room? Okay.
Yeah. So I don't know if we need to notify
No, I know what it is. Is it just a steady beep?
Yes, yeah, it's just okay.
Thank you, Bill.
It's a good idea to bring that up ahead of time.
Yeah, thank you.
Be bad if there was a problem.
I'll take a walk out when I'm
okay.
done with this report.
All right.
First item of business is public input. Any public input? None. We have no students. Continued business, MSBA, SSBC update.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A few things to note for the committee and for the public. I'm anticipating actually a meeting tomorrow at 2 o'clock on a corrective action plan to address issues with the main drainage lines at the site of the middle high school. I don't have a lot of details for you right now, but I do know that there are some concerns that have been expressed by Gilbane Company to our project manager, who in turn has conveyed that to me. So there is a meeting tomorrow at 2. There have been some tests that have of the lines that have not gone as hoped. That some of the lines have failed in the testing, so I'm hoping that coming out of tomorrow's meeting that there will be a corrective action plan presented, and you know, we'll those of us at the meeting will review that and as necessary make any changes that might need to be made in order to ensure that that things are proper.
John, that meeting's in your office?
That meeting is in my office, yes, at 2 o'clock.
Point of clarification on that. That's not a collapse of the lines, that's a failure of the lines to be round, circular in section.
I don't know, Cliff. That it seems like there were a lot of failures.
I don't know the
based
details.
Based on what we heard, we don't know
collapse.
The details.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so, but your background certainly speaks to it more than mine does as far as an engineer. But yeah, I think tomorrow will be, you know, a revealing meeting. I'm hopeful that it's something that can be remedied, you know, quickly and simply. I want to keep you up to date on the training, you know, the very complicated trainings, very complicated AV systems that we have in the middle high school, and they're great, but they do involve an awful lot in the way of training those of us that that use systems in the distance learning lab, the performing arts center, the gymnasium, and such. So we did have a very good training in this room in the distance learning lab back in the spring. We have scheduled a training session for the Performing Arts Center for September 21st with the key players, the theater people from all levels, because the Performing Arts Center does now get used by the elementary schools as well for our burgeoning theater program. So that training will take place, as I said, on September 21st, with the next training to be in the gymnasium. The construction on the installation of the walkway to connect the baseball diamond to the turf field, that began last Wednesday. Michael Connolly and I went, actually we visited all three elementary schools today, and on our way from the Batchelder back to our offices here, we pulled in at the field area and took a look at the walk. I think it looks great. I think they did a very nice job. It's a nice wide walkway.
Is it done?
It's finished. Done. Yeah, it
and
was
that's,
paid.
So that's for handicap access from that parking lot. People can
Correct.
Go right down there, and then it's a flat surface, basically.
It's a very gradual.
Right, gradual. It's a gradual.
It's, it's got a nice it's, curve.
Right,
it
meets ADA requirements Correct. In terms of slope, et cetera.
Right.
Great. Excellent.
So, and again, it's access on that side of the bleachers. There's always the access on the other
Correct.
Side. From the other side, too.
Correct.
But they did a very nice job. They actually paved the area that from when the, going back several years ago when the turf field was installed, there was an area, oh, I don't know, it might have been
15 by 15,
something like yeah. that, yeah, of gravel that had never been paved. They connected the track area to the existing pavement.
They paved
that. I thought it looked really nice.
It looked nice.
He did a little raking out of landscaping.
Yeah, they were going to do some grooming.
Along the edges
yeah.
of where they put yeah. it in, but that's no big deal. So.
One question, and maybe there's a disconnect here. Were they also going to clean the
The brick walkway?
The brick walkway.
It's funny. I don't know that they're responsible for that. I can tell you that when, and Michael, who was with me last week, when we met with the town administrator, Marty Tilton, for another matter down there, a positive matter, we talked, Marty and I had a kind of a side conversation about that walkway and pressure washing it.
Right.
He even had some ideas about potentially putting a, I'll say like a kind of a mulch bed along the run on the side that is between the baseball diamond, just to kind of dress it up a little bit. I think we're kind of waiting until construction gets done. But I think that any kind of cleaning of
is
going to be done internally.
Okay. And the whole grass area because of the summer is just a mess down there.
That area, that baseball area, that's something that, that'll have to be addressed they dug up for the irrigation system.
And such,
that, but
it will need some work.
Without rain, we're not going to be able to get anything. But it needs to be, I think, dug up and leveled.
I agree, and loamed and kind of a, you know, a seed put down.
So. Yep.
And then the last item, I just, you know, we are continuing to address punch list items. And, you know, there are some remaining outstanding items that need to be addressed. And project manager, Gilbane representative, some of you will remember Oliver that was on part of the, he's back.
Yep.
He's working here a few days a week, and it's been very, very helpful, along with Chip from Doran Whittier. So that work continues. And we have a building committee meeting tomorrow night. So,
Mr. Chair, a couple of questions. Cliff, a couple of questions. John, I know last week Iamonte was here. Have they replaced those coils yet, or is that in process?
Good question. It's supposed to be done tomorrow.
Okay.
The coils were received. The gentleman was here with Joe DeSantis from PMA, and I want to say I had a conversation with them on it was either Wednesday or Thursday of last week.
Okay.
And they informed me that they hoped to do that work tomorrow.
The other question is, initially we were told that we were going to have to wait until next spring before the trees, et cetera, are replaced. And then I heard that they're actually going to go out and mark them now. Are they going to be replaced now, or are we still waiting the spring to replace all the dead
trees? I don't know that I have exactly the answer that you want, just only because I don't know that I have all of the information. But I met with Oliver that I was just talking about last, from Gilbane. I met with him last week about the landscaping that's going on around the campus now. And there were a number of shrubs. There were a lot of those spreading yews in the beds at the gymnasium entrance and out front, in the main entrance area, that I asked him to go out with me. He took pictures of them. We identified 24 that he allowed, I'll say he allowed me to have our groundspeople remove now so as not to wait until, so that they could be, you know, I think the idea is that they're leaving things in right now that need to be replaced, so they know what to replace and where to replace them. But they were so unsightly.
And they're right out front there, right?
Right, I wanted them out. They were at the two main entrances, so he worked with me on that. There were 24 shrubs and a tree outside the high school principal's office that he took pictures of, communicated to Gilbane about his granting us to have them removed now. He recorded what was there. And he did in that email to his superior identify that he, you know, thought it would be nice if those could be replaced before the opening of school, but if not, you know, as soon as possible. So I'm telling you that it's a little bit of a long-winded answer, but I think it gets to the point of, I think they're looking to replace what they can replace now, but I don't know that to be 100% true. Okay. But he was certainly going in that direction for the 24 shrubs and the one tree that we identified together.
And the last thing, just want to commend you and Michael and also actually the committee for having the foresight to put into the budget that line item that enabled us to hire an outside resource to come in and do the landscaping. I think that the campus looks really good right now. It's going to look great for the start of school. And once we get that on a schedule, we won't have a situation again where, you know, the weeds are growing up so high that, you know, the place looks unsightly. I don't think that'll happen again now that we have this contractor in place. And I think it looks great.
I do think it got, truth be told, it did get a little bit of ahead of us with the weeds, but we kind of knew that was going to happen. Right. But we were trying to be cognizant of the bottom line and what we spent for the summer.
We had to wait for the new fiscal year.
There was a combination of things. I think it was that. It was our being conservative and not wanting to do too much in July and then having to come back again and do it in August so things would look good for the opening of school when everyone is here. But I think it's fair to say we are committed to it looking good all the time. I was very happy that the high school principal, Mr. LaPrette, coordinated with students. They did a community service day, and they removed about 15 large green trash bags of weeds from out front in the kind of the plaza area, the pavilion area. And I think that kind of thing you're going to see more of. I mean, it's a win-win. The students are in need of community service projects. but it also helps us, you know, and I think it's, you know, it's a little bit of student pride in the building too, and right. So I think it's a nice effort that we're going to try to build.
Great idea, yeah, to move that yeah. forward, yeah.
I commend you too. I think it looks great out there in spite of Gilbane. they've done a good, really good job, and they're continuing to work on it too, so mm-hmm. It looks really nice.
Looks great around the trees.
I think you'll be really thrilled by the end of this week. I asked the landscaper to time things so that he would finish prior to the Labor Day weekend, so when we come back in full on Tuesday. And obviously work is going on with our... This also allowed our internal people, our two employees, to work and concentrate at the three elementary schools.
Right, right.
So they're all of the campus here and the three elementary schools are all getting the traditional sprucing up, if you will.
There's a contractual relationship going on there with Gilbane, which they're supposed to be doing that. At this point, it's still supposed to be doing that.
I think there's some weeding question is, as to how much they owed us under the contract
right.
for the cleanups and for the grass.
Weeding
cast.
Is,
I'm not sure.
They say they
you may be right. Yeah. You may be right. Yeah.
It hasn't been accepted yet.
No, I know.
I'm not sure for that piece of it, absolutely. That's
I'm not sure they'd be required to do the mulching and the edging
right.
and stuff, but yes, for some of the. Yeah.
Things that we add in are on our account.
Right.
But they need to be brought to heal on that tomorrow night.
Agreed, and they will be.
They owe us. All right, I guess that's...
No, one last thing. Finally, the painting that's been done, I don't know if we talked about that. The schools look great. We've added some color. The middle school main hallway, yep. Some of the cafeteria, the main street, the administrative offices, district offices, and I'd like to see that continue, and I think we plan to continue that in the future.
Again, I don't want to... you know, bog down things. But yeah, that ideally what we did, and again, I would want you all to be aware and the public to be aware that was all within budget.
Right.
We reduced our normal summer painting staffing and used the money in that reduction to fund a professional painter coming in all, you know, so kind of new cost neutral, if you will. And again, it allowed our reduced painting crew to concentrate on the three elementary nice. Schools, and they
right.
did that.
But it looks great.
It does. It looks nice. Thank you. No, we were very pleased. And the goal would be to do that over the course of the next, say, two or three summers, a similar type project with other areas in this building to add, just as you said, to add some color.
Great.
I just real quickly, I don't know, were you going to speak about capital improvements tonight? Or
It's on the allotment for the next meeting, but I can certainly speak to.
I think the Hood School paving project
yeah,
was completed
absolutely.
Last week, and it looks really nice. So it's part, you might remember, as part of mm-hmm. one of the capital improvement initiative.
Yeah.
So Mike, that was part of our little field trip today was to go and look at that.
It came out really, really nice.
It did.
I think we addressed all the objectives of the CIPC proposal. And
we did some concrete.
DPW?
No.
Nope, this one was done by EJ Paving, the town.
So the original one was done by.
Correct.
Correct.
Yeah. Year one phase.
Yeah, phase two was done by the contractor. And
we had some concrete work done. You might remember that there were some frost heaves
yes.
that would cause that brick, concrete plaza at the Hood School to mm-hmm. something that they were squares and they would be uneven. We had some granite curbing in that area reset
yep.
to kind of avoid all of that now, and we're hopeful that will accomplish that. But and Wayne Heidecker is working this week for a company to come in and do the striping of the lines and such
yep.
that need to be done.
Okay.
But
somewhat nice.
Building related, but a little bit off the MSA BA report.
Next item on the agenda is new business. We have a first reading of policy EEC, Food Services Management, Student Meal Assistance, and Mr. Connolly?
Yeah, I can provide some context to the purpose of this policy and the meeting that was held a couple weeks ago with the policy subcommittee. So in large part, as a result of the DESE coordinated program review, they certainly that visit that they had last January and that we kind of went through some of the results and findings of that review. One of their recommendations was that all districts kind of formalize in the form of a school committee policy their student mail account charging policy. So they did sort of, we had a procedure that in place that we were using and communicating for the last number of years, and it was sort of their recommendation that we sort of take that to the next level and bring that policy to the school committee for adoption. Many districts have done something similar over the last number of years, and the policy that's kind of before you tonight in a lot of ways comes out of those conversations with the DESC, as well as both myself and Food Service Director Anna McGovern, did really feel like it was time to kind of take this policy and the practices that we've been really operating under for the last number of years, kind of put them more on paper, kind of provide more context and detail to what those are, and bring them, you know, before the committee, which is what we're doing this evening. The policy tonight really was derived by looking at not only our own practices, but also looking at policies and procedures and best practices in about a dozen other school districts that we did look at, all of which have language very similar to the policy that's before you this evening. We did make several changes and really tried to customize and tailor the best practice procedures that we reviewed to really come up with a policy and language that would work best in North Reading and what we were and how we were currently operating. And I think the chief objective of this policy is to, number one, ensure that we have a consistent mail account procedure policy of when we unfortunately do have situations where accounts go into the rear, that we are consistent in what our communication is out to parents and how we're going to go about collecting student mail charges, as well as just to ensure that all students across the district are treated, you know, fairly and in a consistent manner. So I think this policy accomplishes that. We felt very highly that it was, strongly that it was important that students do not go without a mail, and we don't overly identify students that may not have, you know, lunch money on that day, and I think the policy clearly speaks to that, that under no circumstance will a student be denied a lunch. And I think we also felt that we have a certain responsibility and financial due diligence to ensure that we're, you know, timely notifying families that do owe lunch money and accounts that are in the negative, and that we are take a responsibility to collect those funds that are due to the district. So I believe this policy accomplishes those two major objectives, and we certainly tried to find a balance between providing, not denying students lunches, and as well as putting the appropriate procedures and controls in place to collect the funds that are due to the district. Essentially what the policy does, it sets a mail account cap across the district of about 3 mails per student. So at a type A lunch at the elementary level is $2.75. At the secondary, middle school, and high school level, it's $3. So we're operating very closely to between, you know, an $8 and $10 balance amount, a threshold or cap or count cap. And that is very common practice across many of the districts that we looked at. It may range anywhere between 1 and 3 at the secondary level and 3 and 5 at the elementary level. So it was a common best practice and a procedure that was in place. And so we feel that it's a responsible policy. We feel like it's the right thing to do, and the time has come to kind of bring this type of procedure in front of the committee for consideration. But I think in our meeting a couple weeks ago with the policy subcommittee and Superintendent Bernard, I think we felt comfortable with some minor changes of what the language was here, captured here. So I think I'll, any other questions or comments?
Yeah, I just think the key thing is we need to have this in our policy handbook. Right. We don't have a policy on this now. We need to have it in writing. It needs to be codified so parents know students will never be denied a lunch. If you're behind on your account, here's how you need to go about paying the amount you're behind. And other things such as you can call and put a hold on your account for certain items. You can, so correct, it spells out basically everything a parent needs to know about the meal program here, the lunch program. And I'm assuming will this apply to the breakfast program also?
It would, yep. For all meals.
Okay.
Breakfast and lunch.
So I think Janine and I did request some language changes at our subcommittee meeting, but I think we're fine with the overall policy and would recommend approval of on a first reading.
Julie?
So besides being in the handbook, will we be providing this information along with kind of the start of school information that our lunch program offers?
I think once adopted, I think we can certainly...
Or tailor some of the important pieces to kind of go along with...
I think we could blast that out.
That's what I'm thinking.
I would blast out the whole thing.
I think that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I think also a lot of new parents to could be, you know, kindergarten parents, I get a lot of questions about how do we go about setting up an account? What's my student's password? So I think if we could reiterate those important pieces of information as well in that email blast, because then they're, you know, calling school secretaries, what's my password? And I think that would streamline some of that, those questions.
We might want to do that sooner, because for the start of school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That sounds like a great idea.
Yeah. If the committee adopts this, it wouldn't be until September 12th.
Sure.
For second reading. So maybe just those few days ahead of time.
Yeah, we can absolutely do that. I think a blackboard.
That might be helpful to have, like, for
message
next week.
To families. Yes. And I think in a lot of ways, I mean, these are procedures in terms of us using the My School Bucks, you know, account to notify families on a weekly basis, on a regular occurrence, when they're in the negative. And there are low balance alerts that the system automatically generates and alerts parents to. So I think a lot of those communication procedures and how we operate is really not much different. It's just now it's formalized in a written policy.
Mike, I think it's almost important to note that we don't have a major problem here where there are thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars not being paid. It's a minor problem, but we just need to have it as a policy
formalized.
So everybody understands
Correct.
It, right? It needs to be formalized.
Correct.
That's all.
Absolutely.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just add to
the
newsletter that I sent last week, that I know some of you have seen it already,
right.
But I gave you a copy tonight, and Dan, if you don't mind, if for the televised audience, there is, Michael did, in his section of the newsletter, put a little in about food service news. So in the interim, before we get another message out, it might
sure.
be helpful if people just look there, because there is a link to the My School Bucks.
Okay.
System. And that might just, if somebody's
because
curious now.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Students are already enrolled. Parents don't
correct.
Have to enroll them. It's just how to access that
correct.
Information.
That's correct.
Okay. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can absolutely.
I think that would be very helpful.
Informational handout.
Sometimes if it gets overwhelming, you can just pull the salient points and just,
right.
it might make it easier for people
yeah.
to.
Well, just because, you know, the school secretaries are trying to
correct.
Look up information
right,
and,
right,
you know, it's
right.
it's overwhelming at times.
Any further discussion? Is there a motion?
I move to approve for first reading a new policy EEC, Food Services Management Student Meal Accounts.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. All right, next item on the agenda is the fiscal 2018 budget development calendar. Superintendent?
Very good, thank you. So similarly to as in years past, and we seem to be talking about the FY18 and the budget process, you know, earlier and earlier each year, or the budget development process, but essentially, step one in that process is really to agree on a schedule and a calendar, and the dates and calendar and process in place, or the calendar that's before you tonight for consideration, is very similar to the process we've had in the past in terms of key dates of this process to guide the development of the fiscal 2018 budget. As in the past, the process would start with reviewing the district's large capital plan. So September would sort of be devoted, the two meetings in September would be devoted to review of the large capital plan, with the district presenting the large capital plan on the 12th, having time to review, ask questions, and then coming back for additional discussion and hopefully approval at the second meeting in September on the 26th. Because the CIPC's calendar in terms of requests from major departments due into the CIPC will stay the same by September 30th. So it'll be important that we kind of jump right into large capital and have a couple of meetings to discuss and vote the large capital plan. Also, as part of the beginning of the budget development process, we need to issue our fiscal 18 budget goals. So we felt September 26th. And is a time we've done that in the past, so we would review what those fiscal 18 budget goals are again, you know, need to be for fiscal 18, have that discussion, and if we're all in agreement, we could issue goals on that evening or come back at the first meeting in October and vote the goals. Then in October 1, we'll have our official October 1 enrollment count, so the October 17th meeting. would be an opportunity for us to present and revise enrollment projections based on the new October 1 counts. So I think enrollment always plays a huge role in the budget process, and the mid to the end of October would be the time to discuss enrollment. Internally, principals and directors are given their budget request sheets at the end of October every year. That gives them several weeks, or 3 to 4 weeks, to discuss their requests and meet with me and have conversations about fiscal 18. And then those requests would be due into the business office just before the Thanksgiving break. That allows the months of December and January for us to be building drafts and having those further conversations with the administrative team, with the finance planning team, as we prepare to further develop the fiscal 18 budget. I felt a meeting in February, perhaps we could discuss some of the highlights of the preliminary state budget, because that would be due to be released this year at the end of January, beginning of February. So perhaps before we were to present publicly our preliminary budget, we could kind of have that conversation about the state budget and kind of see how that may play into the local budget and where we're at and what the drivers may be. On March 13th, we would present our preliminary budget, similar to what we have done in the past. At that point in time, the budget would be a public document, the budget books would be released, and it would be time to have our first budget workshop on March 23rd, before the public hearing, which would happen on April 10th, similar to what it has in the past, that first week in April. What's different this year on this calendar, we've actually penciled in a date already for what we would, if necessary, a budget workshop number 2. The last 2 years, I feel like a second budget workshop has been necessary once the public hearing has taken place. There's a lot of discussion, a lot of conversation at that hearing, and I think it has helped to kind of come back together, hear that input from the public, from the community, make any changes and so forth, and then come back at the next meeting and discuss those changes. We would be due to present the recommended budget to the Finance Committee at the end of April, and then at the May 1st meeting, we would need to vote the fiscal 18 budget so we can submit to the town in time for the town meeting warrant, and town meeting this year is scheduled for June 5th. So I think this is very similar to what we've seen in the past. I don't know, are there any questions?
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
I mentioned this before, and I don't know what the proper forum is or if this would make sense. I've always felt that it would be good to have a school committee member sitting in on some of the budget meetings if you meet with the whole administrative council, because the school committee member might hear something coming from a principal, say, at the Hood School. They think they should have X. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we don't get all those because they're filtered through you. I'm saying, I don't know if this is proper or not, to at least have a school committee member there to hear, because we don't hear all, so we're out of the loop in terms of all of the needs. You tell us, you don't show them to you say there, believe me, there are a lot more things that were requested. But are there meetings where a school committee representative could sit in and just hear what all of the requests are, or see all of the requests that come in before you whittle them down?
I think you have it in the strategic plan. That's largely what's going to drive our conversation this year.
But aren't there things that each principal would
in the way of personnel
or resources? Or
not beyond that,
I think it's the strategic plan that really drives the personnel requests, and typically is what we'll see come forward. What happens at these administrative meetings is there's further discussion and support around.
We try to get talking needs. Points.
Yeah, but we hear, for example, the high school principal asked for 4 new positions, and we added 1.5 or whatever.
Yeah.
We don't know what those 4 positions are that the high school principal is looking for, because we don't get them here.
The Board of Selectmen, during their budget processes, they bring in every department head on a schedule before the Board of Selectmen mm-hmm. at a public meeting, and they make their presentation to the board as to what their budget needs are. So that's obviously a little different than what we
do. Exactly. That's,
and I'm not necessarily saying I support Mel's suggestion, but that's how they do it with the Board of Selectmen. So
yeah, that's, it's a different process, but that's kind of where this is coming from, where you know, they get to actually hear from the I guess we're hearing from you as
department head,
right?
That's how I would say, yeah.
And then the selectmen question them, you know, they ask them questions.
We're hearing from one department.
I wouldn't want them coming in here and being questioned. I'm just wondering if it would be helpful to have a school committee member rep sit in, that's all. So it's something to consider. We don't have to decide it tonight, just something to consider.
Sure. I think, Michael, I'm sorry, too, because you did give, I think we amended the school committee meeting schedule. I think that October 17th date is now should be October 11th. Because the town meeting date.
Oh, that's town meeting is the 17th, right?
So I think we scheduled a meeting for Tuesday, the 11th.
Yeah, town meeting is the 17th.
Correct.
Right.
Okay.
So is that when you want to do?
Yes.
Okay.
That would be.
That's a Tuesday night, the day after the Columbus Day holiday.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Sorry.
That's fine.
Any further discussion? It's not. That's sounds like a plan.
As revised. Okay. Thank you very much.
Next item on the agenda is an appointment to the North Shore Education Consortium Board of Directors. And you want to?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You may recall this is an annual appointment that the member communities make through their school committees to have representation on the boards. I'm saying plural because the next item on your agenda is a similar request for an appointment to the board of directors at the SEEM Collaborative. So I'm happy to serve. So if the board so wishes, they can appoint me for another one-year term, and I would gladly serve for both positions.
Is there a motion?
I move to appoint Mr. Bernard to be our. Do we have two motions or one motion?
You probably should do two.
Okay, I move to appoint Mr. Bernard as a representative for a one-year term on the North Shore Educational Consortium Board of Directors.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
And I move to appoint Mr. Bernard.
Unanimous.
Move to appoint Mr. Bernard to serve as a North Reading representative for a one-year term on the SEEM Collaborative Board of Directors.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Unanimous.
Thank you.
And now we have routine matters. Minutes for July 25th goals workshop.
Move to approve the minutes as written for the July 25th, 2016 goals workshop.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion is unanimous. Minutes for July 25th open session.
Move to approve July 25th open session meetings as written.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Unanimous. Minutes of July 25th executive session.
Move to approve July 25th executive session as written.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Actually, with one edit. It, on the third line in the second paragraph, it says particular focus on one, creating longer, I think we meant larger, more detailed signs, not longer.
Uh-huh.
Okay, right. Okay.
And that? So I approve with that, move to approve with that correction.
The second still hold?
Yes.
It's the third line under the second paragraph under the, should say larger, not longer.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Unanimous. Budget update, Mr. Conley.
Yes, thank you. This evening I did have one item that I wanted to discuss regarding P cards and a potential, you know, P card program and what that is and how that may benefit the North Reading School District. And I wanted to update the full committee that at the finance planning team meeting held on August 9th, the potential of the district pursuing a P card purchasing program and what those benefits could be was discussed. And essentially, this is something that I've been researching for, I would say for the last, you know, several months, dating back to almost last summer. I've started the research through my affiliation with MASBO, Mass Association of School Business Officials, and so forth, and my conversations with other colleagues who have brought the P-card program to their districts, and they've seen it with some success, and the North Reading is a district that could start to benefit from a P-card purchasing program. And essentially what it is it's essentially a form of a debit or credit card where the district would have the ability to set limits and controls on each card and use that card for specific purchases. It ultimately provides another payment option, and used in certain circumstances, it could help streamline the purchasing process. And essentially, all the existing controls and purchasing procedures and purchase order process that's in place today in the district would continue to be the same. So we're not changing procedures. We're not what the program does is it does require essentially another payment option. And where I see North Reading potentially benefiting from a program like this would be in the after-school enrichment programs, in specific student activity programs, and foreign travel purchases, where we have a lot of staff involved and maybe working with vendors that don't accept the purchase order. And what we're seeing is a lot of employee reimbursements being as a requirement to bring these after-school enrichment programs the supplies that it needs. And you know, this would be a program that I've seen some area districts, you know, the Reading Public Schools, the Masconomet Regional High School and Middle School, use with success in these after-school enrichment programs and student activities. The idea would be to start very small, you know, keep it controlled, only use it for certain programs, for certain staff members, eligible staff members, and still require purchase orders to be, you know, processed. But it would allow that additional level of flexibility. It would reduce the need for us to have several store account cards with local vendors. It would streamline that process. It would cut back on employees, in some cases, hesitating to get involved with being instructors in these after-school programs because they just don't want to maybe upfront some supplies and purchases. So I've had several conversations with the elementary school principals, start dating back to last year, on some of their challenges and their struggles to, I guess, you know, get staff involved. And this was one item that has come up. And I do feel that a P-card program could be beneficial for North Reading. So it's something that I've been involved with. This program in particular that would be discussed was chosen because MASBO, which is the Association of School Business Officials, has already done the procurement and the research and actually chosen this program and actually partnered as a collaborative purchasing agreement with this particular program that allows Mass school districts to kind of sign on and then be a participant in this program. It does require Board of Selectmen kind of approval because there's a series of steps involved in that process, one of which is the Board of Selectmen agreeing to it and signing kind of a resolution that they would agree to be a kind of a P-card member. So I have had extensive conversations with Liz Rourke, town finance director, and I think she's comfortable for us to move forward. It was discussed at the finance planning team held on August 9th, and their recommendation was that I make a short presentation similar to what I'm doing this evening, and ask for their endorsement and sign on into the program. So I guess, this evening I'm looking for an endorsement by the full school committee that would allow the steps to move forward with bringing a P-card program to North Reading. And I do think it's beneficial, and I think there would certainly be controls and procedures in place, and it has some benefits. There would be the district would receive rebates based on the volume of purchasing ultimately used in the program, and you would have access to an online portal to review all the transactions. So I've had a lot of conversations, and it can be used with some success, and I think it's time for us to consider pursuing it. So
do we need a vote on that, or just
I think we're looking for a, not necessarily a vote, Mr. Chairman, but just a blessing, if you will. We'd like to move forward with this.
You need a consensus.
Consensus.
I think that's a good, consensus. That's a fair.
Before So what source of cash is the card tied to? Because it's going to be used for different budget areas.
Yep.
So how do you tie a source of cash to it?
So it would be, it would have to, it was, it's all going to be connected to our general ledger. So it's if it's being used in an after-school program, you know, the encumbrance would have to happen through our general ledger, through our revolving account.
But my question is to the person, you said it could be used at some retail stores instead of the you know, say Office Depot card or whatever, right? So if someone uses it at the Office Depot to buy supplies, when they present the card, is the money coming out of a bank account somewhere, or how is that, how is it working?
Yeah, it would be, I mean, the money would come out of a bank account with the town, but it's going to be, it's going to be tied.
And then we would reimburse the town?
Well,
see, I'm trying to understand, I think it sounds fine, but it makes me nervous when we add another way for people to spend money. That,
yeah,
that's all.
No, it's true, it's fair, and it's been, I think that's the biggest, challenged, but I think it can be controlled in a small environment at first for specific purchases where it wouldn't be, and as long as, to me, I'm comfortable as long as all staff involved continue to follow the purchase order process. And they would encumber POs in advance, similar to what they do now, to ensure that the funding is available.
And is the town doing this too? Are they going to use this card, or?
Liz doesn't, I think she doesn't see the town using it
okay.
right away, but you know, down the road, it's possible.
I heard what you said. I just have a hard time envisioning its use. But I, you know, in general, if you're, you know, you're overseeing it, I'm okay with it. But it just makes me a little
sure.
So besides the Reading and Masco, I mean, I assume there's other districts that
yeah.
used it successfully.
Throughout New England, there's 850 school districts,
yeah.
and I think there's over 40 Massachusetts school districts that use it in some okay. fashion.
Who provides the card? Why is it the P card? What is it a government agency or is it a private bank? Or
it's a private bank. It's a bank.
Okay.
That has partnered with MASBO, who. So town, it's really the town has to kind of agree to sign on because it would be them opening up the bank and having that relationship. So
the card is more or less like a school department debit card.
Yes. Yeah. That's.
And you have you're authorizing certain individuals to
correct.
Use that debit card
correct.
In their purchase.
Yeah.
Rather than. Put it on
correct.
The tab and have the town cut a check later.
Correct.
Voice so it's an advantage
so
to the
less,
merchant.
It's ultimately, less checks the town is cutting. It could be less.
It's doing electronically what's now done manually.
Correct.
Yeah.
So like I said, we would if endorsed and if it proceeds. And I don't see us even using this until a year from now. But it's going to take a while to kind of move through these channels. This is really step one. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, it would be something we would start very, very small, certainly, you know, trial it, see how it works, and, you know.
Control the kind of things that are done with it.
Right.
Yeah, I would just ask that if it's going to, next year, by you mean fiscal 18, not fiscal 17?
Correct.
Or anything, that you come back at some point and give us, for example, will there be a $100 limit on the card, or is the card
yep.
maxed out at $5,000? Or in the whole process of, are we paying back the town? Will we be transferring money to that account from the school budget? I'm just trying to figure out how that works. That's all.
Yeah.
So I'd like a little more detail at some point. Just
yeah.
But I'm in general, I'm
so I mean, essentially, the town finance director. Would in the town treasurer would ultimately control the program. That's why it's kind of a board of selectmen endorsement, because they would set those parameters, and they would obviously work closely with, you know, myself to set the limits on each card and the controls. And you can essentially set specific vendors, assign specific vendors for use on the card as well. But there is a lot of controls you can put in place, which I think is partly the why MASBO kind of has endorsed this particular program, because of the flexibility of setting those limits on each card that you have.
Michael, you'd have direct access to the usage of the card?
Correct.
So that you wouldn't be relying on the town to tell you that to monitor the use. You'd have direct access.
Correct. That's correct.
And would it be, you know, when you know a time presents itself. It could be maybe when an enrichment program is, you know, mm-hmm. in the works.
Correct.
You could have, you know, two cards or one card for the person in charge that you would issue them.
Correct.
Could that card then come back to you?
Yeah,
or how would but that person hold on to that card?
So they would sign out the card for that, you know, the way we
right.
for that program.
Sure.
Use the card, they have to, you know, turn the card back into the okay. business office, sign okay. out, sign in. You know, what we're doing really, what I see us all doing is streamlining the, you know, the 8 to 10, you know, store account cards that we've had to go and sign, you know, store accounts,
sure.
you know, to receive the ability to go do that on a tax exempt, you know, status. It would allow us to kind of have that one card available for these certain programs and purchases.
Instantly establishes the tax exempt position.
Correct.
The merchant gets their
on,
action right away.
Yeah, and there's no cost to the
electronically.
There's no fees.
Processed.
And it could allow some additional. I mean, small, I'm sure, but I think there's. Yeah, I think Masco told me they got $5,000 or $6,000 in a rebate from the use of the program, and that could help. You know, it'd be some small amount of additional revenue as well.
So is there a competition out there for this card where you can get a little better rebate from some other?
But I'd say it's been out there for a number of years. I remember back in 2007, I think they first kind of rolled it out, and is when I first heard of a P-card program. And so it's been, you know, it's been kind of slow to really pick up steam, but it really has the last few years. And I think we could see it helping in some certain situations here.
Does the superintendent recommend it?
I do. I'm glad Michael mentioned about the potential for some revenue to be generated too. And there's a convenience factor here as well for people. It helps to expedite purchases that we might need on a short term. So I do recommend.
Right. So we need a consensus. Julie, are you?
Yes.
On board. Mel.
Okay.
Janine?
Yes.
You got it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
If Michael doesn't show up for work for a few weeks,
we'll the next
postcard.
If the next correspondent is a postcard from the Bahamas. All right. Staffing.
Thank you.
We have a lot of new staff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We do. I have a list in your packet. It's outdated already. We hired a paraprofessional today. At the little school, there was one remaining part-time paraprofessional position. So in your packet is exclusive of that one addition and one position still to be hired, a long-term substitute position for a speech-language pathologist also at the little school. This is the full complement of new staff for 2016-17. We had a very nice two-day new educator orientation program, a kind of our annual orientation program last week. It was very, very good. I want to publicly acknowledge Dr. Daly for his work. That's kind of one of his projects for the summer. He does a very nice job with it. And all of the administrators attended on the first day to introduce themselves and to spend a little time with our new staff. They came back for lunch. Mr. Webster, who traditionally comes, also showed up on Wednesday. Mel, thank you for being there. It's nice to have the committee represented. And I'm very, very pleased with what looks to be a very good and talented and spirited group of people joining our equally talented and spirited veteran staff for a good good start to the new school year, Mr. Chairman.
Good.
One quick question.
Yes.
There's a huge group of special educators.
Yes, there are.
So is this because of the new positions, or because
it's a combination?
We lost some people.
No, it's a combination. Yep, it's I can tell you that there is a special ed opening that was a transfer within the district from the high school to the middle school. There was a transfer from the middle school to one of our elementary schools. There were a number of new positions added as part of the budget. There was at least one resignation in special education at the middle school. Someone who received a leadership leadership position in another district that created a vacancy, and I think that those are, I'm looking at my notes here, but are all of the reasons for the number of special education. But you're right, there are There are a number of new positions in special education at all three levels, elementary, middle, and high school.
John, I see a new school psychologist at the high school.
Yes.
I don't see one at the middle school where we...
The person that was in that position at the high school transferred to the middle school.
Okay, that did happen.
Right.
Okay.
So that filled the new position at the middle school.
Middle school, okay.
And we hired someone new for the high school.
Okay.
Anything further on that?
The paninis were great at the lunch.
Yes.
They were really good.
Really good.
That's the primary reason Mel goes.
No, because Anna McGovern made John's panini, and I said, I'm going to have what Mr. Bernard had, and it was excellent.
Chef great special, lunch. I tell her. I never really know what I'm getting, but it's always good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, next item on our agenda is a long list of bids and donations. And the first one it's listed is $100 from Kitty's Restaurant. Are there
Mr.
any?
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve $100 donation from Kitty's Restaurant. to support the proposed improvements to the athletic facilities at the North Reading Middle School, High School.
Second.
Second.
Mr. Chairman, move to approve. This
you
is
wanna,
with gratitude.
Want to vote on that one?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay. Go ahead. I'm trying to move with gratitude.
All right. Are there any comments on that?
I just want to mention we got a bunch. There were a bunch of donations tonight related to the irrigation and sod project
right.
at the new school fields.
That's the project I think these are earmarked for.
There are
many of these, yeah.
They're associated with that, yes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Second is Frank Prusik Painting.
Mr. Chairman,
$100 donation.
Move to approve a $100 donation from Frank J. Prusik Painting to support the proposed improvements to the athletic facilities at North Reading Middle School, High School.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Second. Second. Julie seconded. We got a process.
Now who's trying?
I got a second.
Yeah, Julie seconded.
Yeah, Julie's going to
second.
We're
not doing very well. Aye.
All aye. I think we're all in favor.
It was in unanimous.
Yes.
The next one is Dooley and Mason Realty Group, $200 to support proposed improvements to the athletic facilities.
Mr. Chairman, move to approve accept with gratitude a $200 donation from Dooley and Mason Realty Group to support the proposed improvements to the athletic facilities at North Reading Middle School High School.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Next is North Shore Printing, Inc., $200 to support proposed improvements to the athletic facilities.
Mr. Chairman, move to approve a $200 donation from North Shore Printing, Inc. to support the proposed improvements to the athletic facilities at North Reading Middle School, High School.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Unanimous. Next is Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Kern, $300 to support improvements to the athletic facilities at North Reading Middle High School.
Move to accept with gratitude a $300 donation from Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Kern to support a proposed improvements to the athletic facilities at North Reading Middle School, High School.
Second.
Very generous donation.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Ron goes way back with North Reading youth soccer and still referees 15, 20 games a week in the season. So thanks a lot, Ron and Nancy.
And next is from Graphique de France Company and Kind Contributions, 100 Daily Planner Books, North Reading High School.
Move to accept with gratitude 100 daily planner books as an in-kind contribution from Graphique de France Company for the planner books to the North Reading High School, estimated value of $300.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Next is China Cuisine, Inc., $1,000 to support improvements at the athletic facilities, North Reading Middle High School.
Mr. Chairman, move to approve with gratitude a $1,000 donation from China Cuisine, Inc. to support the proposed improvements of the athletic facilities at North Reading Middle School, High School.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. The next is Bachelor School Parent Association, $1,879.98 for two projectors and two mounting brackets.
Mr. Chair, move to accept with gratitude a donation of $1,879.98 from the Bachelor School Parent Organization for two projectors and two mounting brackets.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. And next is North Reading Middle School Hornet Productions, in-kind contribution of storage container to be used for theater Store theater props and equipment, estimated value of $6,500.
Mr. Chairman, move to accept with gratitude an in-kind contribution of a storage container valued at $6,500, said contribution from the North Reading Middle School Hornet Productions.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Last is Mr. and Mrs. Douglas Carey, in-kind contribution to the fence of North Reading Middle School, High School, in the area between their personal home property and town property, located at the tennis court, estimated value of $6,500.
Mr. Chairman, move to accept an in-kind contribution of a fence valued at $6,500 to be installed at the middle school, high school complex, adjacent to the tennis courts and behind the property of the Careys. Donation made by Mr. and Mrs. Douglas Carey.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Question on this. Do we need to sign this agreement tonight?
Yes, I think is it required the signature of everybody? It looks like it.
It has a slot for the selectmen and for the school committee, yes.
Yeah.
And I think we probably ought to have a separate vote for that.
Right.
So is there a motion for accepting this memorandum?
I move to approve the license agreement would we approve that or the town approve that?
It's both bodies, okay. The selectmen and the school committee.
I move to approve the license agreement between the school committee and Douglas and Mary Carey related to the construction of a fence behind the school property,
mm-hmm.
Separating the Carey's property from the school property.
A second. Just for the record, this fence will be on school property. That's
yes.
The whole purpose of the memorandum of understanding.
And this has been reviewed and approved by council, correct?
Council drafted it.
Yes.
Memorandum of agreement, yes.
Right.
And Michael Gilberto and I, the town administrator and I, did a conference call with him to review that prior to it coming to you.
Okay.
Mm. And for further information, the reason that this is on school property and not on their property is because of a number of large trees that are essentially on the line.
Right.
Could always cut them down.
I don't think that's a good idea.
I think that's
counterproductive. I wouldn't recommend that, Jerry.
No more trees.
No.
It's made and seconded.
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
And again, Mr. Chair, thank you to all the people that have donated, particularly, there's some very generous donations across the board there, but the ones that came in for the high school facilities is
very well appreciated.
Right,
and we'll get into more
details
when we do the athletic facilities.
Mel will give you an update.
Right. But I want to second Jerry's.
Hey, we have
nice response from people.
Yeah. Subcommittee updates. Policy subcommittee met on August 3rd. Mr. Webster and Mr. Zimbriano.
We already discussed that was the policy related to the meal program.
That's all you did?
That's all we did. Sorry, Mr. Chair.
That was good. That was good work.
Finance planning team met on August 9th. And Mr. Bowers and Mr. Venezio will provide an update.
I'll call on the superintendent to support us too. But we did talk about projected revenues coming up for the next fiscal year, and as usual and responsibly so, the chairman and the town administrator and the finance director for the town are very conservative about the projections, the revenue projections. So I think it's something we have to be conscious of. Michael had already talked about the P-card thing. I think we talked about getting close to closing out the school project as well, and where we're at. And I think we still have a little ways to go. We have meetings tomorrow, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still trying to work with Gil Bain and trying to come to a final figure as far as the closeout, but there's still some things that remain to be completed before we can do that. So I'd go back to Cliff and John about anything else.
I think we talked a little bit about the little school roof. I think the finance planning team was looking for an update, and that project remains on budget, which was good was and is good news. There was a little bit of talk about the lavatory facilities to be built
at the turf field,
Kenny Field. We talked a little bit about that. And I think maybe a little different than we had been used to, at least in my experiences, we were asked to submit kind of a draft pro forma budget three fiscal years out. And I think we talked a little bit about that and, trying to give a kind of some early notice as to what we think our needs might be for a more extended period of time than we typically do.
Yeah, there was the performance contracting with Johnson Controls proposal.
Yes, yeah.
And I think we received kind of endorsement or consensus to have Johnson Controls come through both school and town buildings, look at what some type of large capital projects could be undertaken that would potentially lead to energy savings that the town could entertain entering into the form of a performance contract with Johnson Controls. So they had done a preliminary assessment on school and town, just kind of on paper, just looking at usage information and data, and now we authorize them to move forward with some on-site assessments to try to support that data and see if that if the information will be the same. So I think my understanding was that work took place at the end of last week into this week, and we'll just kind of wait for those findings.
But as always, it was a cordial and productive meeting.
We talked about
school
a lot.
Committee,
good.
The school good. Committee, the Board of Selectmen, and the Finance Committee representatives.
I don't miss those. I had to get up too early for those meetings.
Yeah, they are at 8:15.
Yeah, no, that's really out of my wheelhouse.
Perhaps as important as anything is that we're looking at a continued bleak revenue from the state.
Right. And big story in the Globe today.
Serious issue. SSBC.
We talked that out, didn't we?
We discussed.
I would say again, we're continuing to work with Gil Bain and PMA and Doran Whittier to try to close out the project. I think the two major issues that remain for us are the landscaping and the drainage right now. So we'll move forward trying to get those things resolved.
Perhaps HVAC is still there, but.
Well, that's
moving along, and hopefully the repairs are made by Iamonte on the coils.
Yeah, that's scheduled for this week. The HP, we've had some good progress this summer working with some the contracted services that you all endorsed and in regulating that. So
I've already seen the savings of that.
Yeah. As we mentioned earlier, too, we have to finish the AV training as well.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. So that has to be done. But we're getting there.
So this contractor coming in to work on the HVAC system, is this kind of the end of?
There was something that was.
These were repairs.
Right.
Needed to be
right.
made.
But we're assuming this could be the end.
Good question, Julie.
Well.
I think there may be a couple of issues remaining, but.
But this is one of the big ones.
This is a significant
larger
one.
Right.
Pretty much the end.
Right. We're working down on the punch list.
Yeah.
And the good news on this is that it was damaged, so it was covered by insurance.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So there's no out-of-pocket. And, in fact, the contractor agreed to come back and do it.
Correct.
For the insurance. The
same contractor that installed the whole system. We thought that was a prudent move. To
We're not. It really probably wasn't an installation mistake. It was somewhat of a,
it's a combination.
Winterproofing
mistake
type of thing. Yeah. So.
All right. Athletic facilities.
Athletic subcommittee.
No, athletic facilities committee. A couple of things. We meet tomorrow to go into detail. We opened the new bids. We went out to bid a second time, which was what the August 9th meeting really focused on, in trying to raise additional money. And we're happy in that we actually got a low bid that was approximately $7,000 lower than the low bid the last time around. It looks like we're about 18,000 out of whack, somewhere between 18,000 and 20,000. However, the way the bid was set up, we're going to move ahead with the irrigation part of the program. Once Michael Connolly is checking references right now, he's been in contact with the company that had the low bid, but we have not awarded the bid yet. The bid was 141,000 plus, correct?
Correct.
And we have about $123,000. We're quite confident we can pick up the $18,000 needed to complete the entire project. The other item Mr. Bernard touched on is the restroom facilities at Kenny Field. The bids for the planning and design are scheduled to come in this Thursday.
Correct.
And then once those bids have come in, $50,000 was approved by town meeting for that project for the design and planning.
Yeah, and that's going to be, there's going to be a warrant article on
right.
On
once
the,
we get the
warrant for town meeting.
Right. The plan is to look at three options. We want the company that comes in to look at the planning and design, current use of the current storage facilities, reworking those to become restrooms, which would then require a building to be constructed for storage. Building a new restroom facility, or building a new restroom plus concession stand.
I think we've had 9 designers actually show interest in the project.
Have taken out
the
paperwork.
Taken out the paperwork, yeah.
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 I have one question about that. I was down there a lot for soccer this weekend. Where would the new bathroom potentially concession stand
be? Well, that's what part of the planning and design is going to be, but when we've looked at it, the place that makes the most sense to us is where the current concession stand is.
Right.
To tear that down.
But that's the only place that looks like.
That'll be part of this proposal, I think.
Sure.
We had a locate.
I know some people have also talked about you could put it on the other side on the baseball field. I don't know if that would work, but that's like the only place I could see.
Centrally located is it's going to be down there.
Exactly. Exactly.
I think it's fair to say that's the site we would be looking at unless someone told us that it's not the best site for it, but that's where
and that's
all the
okay site like with the town that's
there's gas and water at that site.
Right. There's electricity too.
Electricity, yeah.
And it's near the the wastewater interact.
It's near the pump for the current restrooms that are in the team rooms.
Facilities are there.
So I think that probably wraps up. I will say that at the when we discussed the raising funds for the sod and irrigation project, there was a lot of input from members of some of the various youth sports programs in town. And we sent out a letter to about 50 or 60 businesses, and then Rita Mullen sent out a letter to alumni. And then there was a letter in the paper, there was a picture in the paper. To be honest, I think we've raised a phenomenal amount of money in about 6 months for this project.
Yeah. And I think the selectmen are still up in the air as to whether or not they're going to put a holder on the warrant to maybe deal with this.
I think they put a placeholder, but they haven't agreed to put an item on the warrant yet.
So that's still up in the air. I know Mike Prisco is pushing it.
I have communicated with Selectman Prisco, letting him know what the bid was and letting him know what the dollar difference is where we're at right now. And he was appreciative of that and said, you know, he'd continue to push for it.
I mean, our goal is really to get this done in the fall.
Right. If we get it done in the fall, then the fields can be used 100% in the spring. If we have to wait till the spring to put in the sod, then we might not even be able to play softball there in the spring. So that's why we want to get it done in October, by middle October.
Yep. And that would be the timeline under the terms of the proposals that we received was to have substantial completion by October.
Right. Yep.
So were the selectmen willing to fund the difference? Is that
we don't know. It's don't kind know. Of a again, Mr. Prisco is supporting it. He's trying to get them to get on board.
They did agree to a placeholder on the warrant, but they did not agree to put
to
definitely put an item on the warrant requesting the funds.
If you want to get the project done by mid-October, it's going to be a little tight on the
I mean, we have to still look at other areas of funding, and there are additional things we need to purchase for that site, including soccer goals and
but those are secondary.
Right, but I'm saying that we still need to raise the funding. Sure. However, if we get the indication that the warrant will have to be completed in September, and if they do put an item on for the difference or for a certain amount of money, I'm quite confident it would pass it at town meeting.
We also have a meeting tomorrow night at 6:30 with the Athletic Facilities Committee, so that we're going to get the word out there how much money we need and see if we can find a way to get it as soon as possible.
Correct.
Anything further from the Athletic Facilities Committee?
Nope.
Okay, how about the Athletic Subcommittee met on August 23rd?
Yeah, Mel's already covered very well the first item on our agenda that day, which was the facilities at Arthur Kenny Field. We talked about the high school fall sports signups. At the time, there were 312 athletes signed up. That was on August 23rd. John, you've updated us on that.
It's over 350
over
today.
350, and that's high.
That's very unbelievable.
That's high.
That
I believe,
be the highest
I believe, and I don't know, but I know at the beginning of the week, I think we had more than 60 players signed up for football.
I think it was almost 70.
Yeah, I think it was 78.
Which is a huge, huge number.
Soccer was very
soccer
large
huge.
Yeah, today when I went.
Both boys and girls?
Yeah, they both large.
Boys huge. And girls?
Yeah, big, big numbers.
Dave Johnson, our athletic director, continues to pursue the cooperative ski team with Haverhill High School. That's in the works, in progress. I don't think it's been signed, sealed, and delivered yet, but it's
correct.
In progress. We have a deal on the girls' ice hockey team. It's a co-op team with Peabody and Linfield. I think we're going to go into another year with that particular agreement.
Right.
So that they'll continue to play in that Peabody, Linfield, North Reading team. Obviously, the wrestling team continues to work the co-op program with Linfield. The athletic facility, we talked about that. Fields maintenance, I think the irrigation system that we have on the baseball field is up and running and working efficiently.
Yes, it is.
I think you can see some of the results of that out there when you look at it. Again, the field facilities maintenance for the athletic fields is a cooperative, collaborative effort between the town and the school department, and it works out pretty well between Marty and Marty Tilton and Wayne working together on that. We talked about getting the lights on the tennis courts. We have the lights. We're talking about getting a timer installed, and I think John's working with a contractor to do that.
The last date we had on that, Mr. Venezia, was Thursday, right? September
Correct.
1st? Yeah,
yes.
So I think it's on or around that date. And actually, I sent an email to Wayne this afternoon just to see me tomorrow about the language. We're going to have some signs.
And Marty was also working. Was Marty going to talk to make sure that, because one of the things is we want to make sure that it can be turned on but not be on.
Correct.
Be off here, right?
So that's right.
I don't know if you want to go and just spend a minute explaining exactly
on
how
the lighting?
It would work. Right, yeah.
Sure.
I thought the community might be interested.
Right.
I think it's important.
I agree. So essentially what we're hoping to achieve and what we think we can achieve is that the town could set the lighting system up at the tennis courts, that the lights would be on if someone wanted them to be on until 9:30. So they would always turn off at 9:30. But they wouldn't always be on until 9:30. It's only if someone were to go over and activate them through this system that we're hoping to have installed sometime, you know, on or around September 1st. So, for example, if someone were to go out now and it's not light enough to play tennis and they want to activate the lights, they would hit this button on this new system and it would activate the lights for a period of time that we designate, 30 minutes, 45 minutes, something like that, 60 minutes. So it being 7:30, that would, you know, at the end of that period, you might have to hit it a second time. But if that window exceeded the 9:30 time slot, they would automatically shut off at 9:30. So for the neighborhood and for just, you know, kind of common courtesy, if you will, whatever, it would always be a 9:30 shut off.
Well, we've had a high level of community activity at the tennis courts,
yes,
and this will afford them, particularly in the fall and the spring.
When we left my office to come down here tonight, it was busy. You know, they get
them
a ton
the
of
opportunity
use.
To,
so one question on that. Are we going to... I think we have to obviously keep a close watch on the cost. We've estimated it may cost, Marty Tilton has estimated around $30 an hour. I think it's $50 an hour down
Correct.
Here. Correct. Are we going to make that available every night, or will we lock the door? Will some nights it won't be?
I wasn't thinking of that. I was thinking
I guess as
nights.
Long as we keep a close watch on the cost. I mean.
Yeah, and we will do that. You know, we get a monthly report
right.
for our electric use, which has been very good. Actually,
yes,
at this campus,
been.
It's been very good. Obviously, when the you might remember last year after the fall before the winter season we closed them
right.
So they wouldn't be on for a period of whatever five or 6 months whatever that time is but
I guess the question is Michael would this come right in would just be part of the electric bill for the high school middle
school? It would yeah it would be probably on a separate meter that we would get billed for as part
but,
of our
okay bills. So it would be
yeah.
separated out so we could see exactly
it would.
How okay
that's my anticipation.
I'll say this too right. Last year we only did it once. I think they may do it more this year, but in the spring we had a dual meet
against
the boys
Austin Prep.
And the girls
right.
tennis team playing Austin Prep on the same night under the lights
right.
And it was a huge crowd there. Really worked
out
nice.
Well, it was great.
Really nice,
beautiful
yeah.
course
yeah. So
John, will we have anything as far as informing the public of this
yes.
availability
and
how
I,
it will
and
work?
This is, you know, that, the, yes, and the reason I was waiting on having the signs made, because the signs are going to speak to how someone could operate the lights, and we weren't exactly sure on what the system was going to be mm-hmm. that we would have installed and if it could be done, and so I wanted to wait until we got.
I'm just thinking like, you know, something for the transcript or something.
Yeah,
and let
people yeah.
know. You know, I think yeah, I think that's, you know.
Okay. The subcommittee schedule is the SSBC meeting is scheduled for tomorrow at 5:30 here. Athletic Facilities Committee is tomorrow at 6:30 in the superintendent's office.
Won't that be here?
It is. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Okay.
I guess that's
yeah.
my
correction.
Okay.
Sorry.
The finance planning team is meeting September 12th at 8:15 in the superintendent's office. Athletic Subcommittee on September 21st at 12:30 in the superintendent's office. And the NORCAM Board of Directors meeting is September 22nd at 7 p.m. in NORCAM's office. Administrative report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So a few things. I mentioned just a little bit ago about the little school roof. So I'm happy to tell you that the work continues in earnest on that project. I think that the most important thing to note is that the project does remain on schedule and it remains on budget. I think it's fair to say that we are looking at a late September, early October substantial completion date. The project has gone, I would say it has largely gone very well. Michael and I have visited, we were there this morning.
Yes.
We talked with the project manager. It's, you know, there's been a few little glitches along the way. Nothing, I would say, that's terribly alarming. You know, for example, some vibration today caused a smoke detector to go off. You know, those kinds of things. We've had some ceiling light fixtures dislodged because of electrical. We did, as some of you know, because I spoke to you about it at the end of last week, find some, and this was not unexpected, some dampness in what they call the gypsum decking once they removed kind of the exterior, the top layer of roof material. But we got some good news on the remedy for that, and that work actually started today. It started right away. So there have been a few little hiccups, but I really, nothing that is all that significant, but I do think it's important for people to know that, you know, it hasn't been, 100% smooth, but it's been pretty darn close, quite honestly. I'm very impressed with the level of communication from the project manager. We get literally a daily report with photographs. Our custodial staff has been working diligently with them to, you know, keep the building maintained through their summer cleaning around some obstacles that present themselves. But again, nothing that I don't think has been unexpected. And again, project remains on schedule and on budget. All along, we knew that there would be some construction going on in September when students and staff returned to school, and that maintains, to be the case. The light is at the end of the tunnel, so to speak.
Parking lots will be available for the first day of school.
Parking lots. We don't anticipate any snags. Company's been very good to work with. Stanley Roofing.
Yeah. They got a lot of guys working over there.
I'm glad you said that because it's in my report to you. They did work on one Saturday, August 20th. They've got as many as 13 people now working on the crew. They are, my sense is, my impressions are, my belief is that any building project meetings I've gone to or conversations I've had, they are extremely understanding of what we're up against with it being a school. And it's been very nice to have that level of respect for, you know, understanding their children, their staff, you know, the minimal noise interruptions and such. They've been extremely understanding of that. So, and to try to achieve as little disruption as possible, they have worked on a Saturday. They've added people to the crew. So that's been a good thing. I included in your packet, our digital learning coordinator, Dan Downs, has really been a very good resource for us in digital learning, and I attached for you a couple of documents regarding a symposium that's going to be hosted on September 23rd at the offices of Amazon in Cambridge. This is a very high-quality, proud moment for North Reading to be a part of this. If you look at the last page of what I've provided with you, when you look at some of the districts across the country that are part of the Go Open initiative, you'll see very few in Massachusetts, and the North Reading Public Schools is now one of them. And we are the co-sponsor, the co-host of this technology symposium. I will be going it's on a Friday, September 23rd. To learn a little bit more about educational resources, technology resources in education. It's really a nice thing for our district, and Dan Downs is the person that really linked us up. So I think it's an important thing for you as school committee members to be aware of, and for the community too.
I think one of the interesting things about it too is the path it's pursuing using open source software could down the line save money.
Correct.
For school districts.
Yeah, the idea is, my understanding of it is that there's a lot of available resources that people collaborate around,
right,
and there is ultimately a budgetary savings.
Yeah.
And a lot of it's very, very up to date. I mean, in my world with technology, when I hear Amazon, I think, you know, that's big. That's big stuff.
Yep.
So good for our digital learning department.
John, I just had a
question.
What does it entail as far as North Reading hosting it?
It means that we are a district that has been identified as one that has something valuable to share.
Okay.
In our work in digital learning.
So will our digital learning people be there?
No, it's just through Dan. It's through Dan Downs.
Okay.
And like I said, I'm going to go. I think Dr. Daly's going to join me too, more in support of him, sure. But also to learn and see. You know, I think it's important for us to kind of have a frontline view into what some of the resources might be that we can bring back to our district too. There's no cost to our district to be a part of this. It's a win. The other attachment to my report is just, I know some of you received this electronically, but I provided you with a copy of my summer newsletter. I would like to just take a quick moment about the opening of school, kind of a couple of things around that. I'm very, very grateful to all of the work that gets done in the summer. You know, for all of the years that I've worked in education, and particularly around the years that I have been an administrator, of which I think I'm going on my, 14, I think it's 22 out of my 30 years, the question gets asked a lot, you know, what do you do in the summer? You know, it's always a very hard question to answer because it's just the myriad issues that come up and the just the normal day-to-day things that get interrupted. But it's all good, fun work to ready schools for opening day. And I can tell you confidently, and I can tell the community that we are very, very close to being fully ready, and we certainly will be ready on opening day. And there's a lot of people that contribute to that, and it's custodial staff, buildings and grounds staff. We get wonderful cooperation from our town agencies, public safety personnel. Department of Public Works collaborated with our buildings and grounds people on a project at the little school with the removal of a kind of an outdated and unsafe playground piece of equipment. As I said, public safety. People come in voluntarily and give their time over the summer. All of our administrators, we have a very, very good team of people working to quote unquote get the job done, and I'm very grateful for that. And again, I can confidently tell you that we will have all of our schools ready for arrival of staff and students on the first official day of school, September 7th. But just a reminder, we do have a professional development day for staff on this Thursday, September 1st, and then our traditional opening day ceremony with staff on September 6th. I included that in my report too, and I would just like to remind you all that we will have kind of our kind of like just to kind of welcome back coffee and such at 7:30 with the formal program beginning at 8:30. So I'm hoping you can all be there. Mr. Bowers, you'll address the staff.
I'm prepared.
Staff. Okay,
yes,
very good.
I've been working on my my volume of
excellent
material.
I was going to go, but now I'm reconsidering. You've got a volume of material.
It's only about 60 or 70 pages.
Excellent. They'll be happy to hear from you, then probably more than they will to hear from me. I don't know. So just a reminder, school opens for grades students in grades 1 through 12 on Wednesday, September the 7th. We will have pre-kindergarten and kindergarten orientation on that same day, as well as Thursday, September 8th, with our kindergartners and pre-kindergartners starting on Friday, September 9th. And that is all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Good.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think you have an under correspondence. Yes, you do. One more fire. The Diamond Club, Scott Ellis had asked me to share with the committee. The Diamond Club is hosting a golf tournament, first annual golf tournament, on Friday, October 7th at the Hillview Country Club. And as you all know, they are very good friends to our school community through sponsorship, donation, and such. In-kind contributions, and so I was glad to tell Scott that I would share that all with you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
very much.
They've done some great work at the baseball field, and Scott
really do.
He has done some great work.
He does. He's very, very, very kind.
Future business: we have a regular meeting on September 12th at 6:30 right here. September 26th, regular meeting here at 6:30. October 11th. It's a Tuesday, 6:30, regular meeting here. And October 17th at 6:30, we have a town meeting, before town meeting, meeting in the superintendent's office. And we have a need for an executive session. Do I have a motion on that?
Yes, I'll make a motion to discuss. We're not going to hear the grievance. We're going to discuss.
The personnel matter.
Personnel matter related, and also to discuss school safety and security protocols, and to reconvene for the purpose of adjournment.
I second that.
Okay, we need a roll call vote. Yes. Mrs. Kopke?
Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I guess that's the end of our meeting here. Thank you very much.